I don't see. There's April. You guys ready?
Thank you. Good morning. How are you? How are you? I really genuinely want to know. I'm so glad to see you, Terry. Good morning. All right. A couple of quick announcements. First off, this month at our Daily Bread, we do need some donations. We have drop boxes by all the doors in case you haven't seen them before. But this month, they're asking for donations of canned fruit again. That was last month. They need more. And also canned soups. Starting to get to be fall weather, great season for soup. So if you could bring those and drop them either in the drop boxes at the exits or during the week in the church office, there's a shopping cart, you can drop those things off there too. Also, we talked about it last week, the trick or treat on Main Street is coming up and our church has a great ministry to reach out to children in our community and we speak to them with sugar. And so we're asking for fun-sized candies, not the teeny tiny ones, but fun-sized that are easy to stick a sticker on. Donations, you can drop them right over here on this corner by our little crooked house, and we'll make sure they get into good hands. Also, ladies in the audience, the Weta Bailey Bible Study is starting back up. They take a break every summer, but the new season for Bible study is starting. So next Sunday, October 7th at 4 o'clock will be the first session of that. They'll be studying Priscilla Shire's One in a Million. It looks like a great study. The sign up and more information for all of that is online at the church website at fumcroycecity.life or .org. So you can go on there and see which dates they'll meet. It's kind of sort of the first Sunday of each month, but it does change a little bit. So every other week. Thank you. My bad. I looked at the dates on that, and for some reason it didn't register. Every other week. And finally, we do have Kindles back by the door. If you need help signing up for that Bible study or any of other, see, Sherilyn is holding them up this morning. Any other group that you might be interested in, if you're looking for a service opportunity, everything is on the website. That's your go-to place if you have any questions. But again, my name is April. I'm so glad to see you this morning. It's a little cloudy and melancholy out, but the Holy Spirit is here. So get ready to worship. Thanks for being here this morning.
So now it's time to focus on worship this morning. So let's stand and sing some praise.
Of your mighty never cease to worship you, and shout to the Lord on the earth, let us sing power and majesty, praise to the King. Mountains bow down and the seas will roar at the sound of your name, and I sing for joy.
Pray. Father God, sometimes we wonder how we've gotten through some difficult situations, and then we realize that you were there with us, lifting and comforting our spirits. When we struggle and we worry, remind us that your loving presence sustains and strengthens us. Lord, when the noise of the world gets too loud for us, help us to seek you and listen for your voice to guide us. In your blessed name, amen. Amen.
Blessed be your name in the land that is plentiful, where your streams of abundance flow. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name when I'm found in the desert place, though I walk through the wilderness. Blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be your name when the sun's shining down on me, when the world's all as it should be. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name on the road marked with suffering, though there's pain in the offering. Blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. You give and take away. You give and take away. My heart will choose to say, Lord, blessed be your name. You give and take away. You give and take away. My heart will choose to say, Lord, blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name, Jesus. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name.
You can all be seated now.
finding myself at a loss for words. And the funny thing is, it's okay. The last thing I need is to be heard, but to hear what you would say. Word of God, speak. Would you pour down like rain, washing my eyes to see your majesty, to be still and know that you're in this place. Please let me stay and rest in your holiness. Word of God, speak. In the midst of you, beyond the music, beyond the noise, all that I need is to be with you, and in the quiet to hear your voice. Word of God, speak. At a loss for words, and the funny thing is, it's okay.
Well, good morning. My name is Chris Everson, and I'm the pastor here, and we are so glad that you are here with us in worship this morning. You know, it's kind of one of those hazy mornings where you step outside and you look around and you go, blah, right? And it kind of feels like a blah day, but you know what? We are here in the midst of family. We're here in the midst of God's presence, so we give thanks. And we give thanks and we go to God in prayer. So if you haven't yet already, if you had to take the prayer card or the tab that's on your bulletin and rip that off and register your attendance with us this morning. And on the other side, if you have a prayer concern that you would like to lift up to the church, please fill that out and place it in the offering basket as it comes around later in the service. Because every Tuesday, and this Tuesday, our staff's having a very special meeting where we are looking at planning ahead for 2019, but we'll spend time in prayer for those prayers that you lift up in our service, because we know that prayer is important, and we want to be praying for you as your staff. We do have some additions that we would like to add to our prayers this morning. We lift up Mark Binko, who has been diagnosed with a heart condition. We also pray for the family of James Cato, who died in a car accident. We pray for Shirley Magnus, who has surgery on Wednesday. And we lift up the Cox family of Wolf City, Amy Cox, who is a teacher, also passed away Friday night driving home from a volleyball game. So we lift up their family upon that death. We also lift up sad news that one of our own, Graydon Whitney, he passed away yesterday. Tracy and I, we had a chance to be over there before he passed away to pray with Beverly and family, and also to be with them afterwards. We don't have any details yet about services, because I think Beverly is going to be talking with the funeral home tomorrow. But as soon as we know, we will post information on our Facebook page. We'll have information through our prayer chains. And of course, if you are not on any of those things, and if you want to call the office, I'm sure by Monday afternoon, we'll have that information that you can call the office, and we'll be glad to pass that on to you. We do have a celebration I would like to add this morning. Sean, you have a birthday coming up, don't you, buddy? He had a birthday on the 27th. So happy birthday, Sean. Yeah. So with those prayers that we have on our heart, I think I got everybody. Hopefully I did. I believe. So with those prayers that we have on our hearts and our minds, you know, it's always good just to take a moment, just to still ourselves and allow God's Spirit to move in and through us as we go to God in prayer. So I invite you just to take a moment to silently lift your prayers up to God, and then we'll join together and we'll close with the Lord's Prayer. So would you please go to God in prayer with me? Oh God, we come to you as your people. And on mornings where we feel a lot of pain, a lot of sadness, we know that we can lean on you and lean on your presence in our lives. We pray that you be with those that we love who are experiencing loss right now, and how those losses can just move through an entire community, and how those losses feel so gut-wrenching or deep in our lives. So God, we cry out. We cry out for wholeness. We cry out for your peace. We cry out for those families who are mourning today, and those who are most affected by these losses. Allow your Spirit to rest with them, to be with them, to comfort them, to fill them with your presence. And God, as a church, we pray that you allow us to be by their side, to walk with them in these dark valleys. But God, you call us to do much more than that. You call us to be a light in darkness. You call us to be your hands and feet. You call us to reach out with compassion and love. So God, as we spend this time in prayer, as we spend this time giving ourselves over to you, our lives, our plans, our sorrows, our joys, we lay them down to you. And we're reminded that we do not do this alone, but we do this as a community of faith. As together, we lift up the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. This time I'd like to invite the ushers forward to receive our offering. And as they come forward, next month, starting on October the 7th, we are beginning our stewardship campaign. And the stewardship campaign helps us look forward to 2019 for the ministry and for the work that we do together as a church. So next week we will be passing out commitment cards for not only just our offerings, our tithes and our offerings, but also commitment cards for the other areas of membership that we have vowed to as a church, to be present in our prayers, our presence, our gifts, our service, and our witness. So I invite you now to start praying with us and to seeing how God will use you and how God will allow your generosity to do the amazing work that we have already done as a church and continue the amazing work into the next year as we continue to find ways to make disciples for the transformation of the world. So thank you again for your generosity, for allowing us to be that church. So as we take time to give our offerings back to God, let us go to God in prayer. Holy and gracious God, you have blessed us in so many ways. So as we take this opportunity to return our tithes and offerings to you, we ask that you bless them and use them so that more and more people can experience your love and grace through Royse City First United Methodist Church. And so God, we lift this offering up to you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Truth is harder than a lie. The dark seems safer than the light. And everyone has a heart that loves to hide. I'm a mess and so are you. We build walls nobody can get through. Yeah, it may be hard, but the best thing we could ever do, bring your pride. Freedom found when we lay our secrets down at the cross. So bring your brokenness and I'll bring mine. 'Cause love can heal what hurt divides. And mercy's waiting on the other side. If we're honest. So
kids, if you want to come down front, Miss Wanda's up here to talk to you this morning.
Is it on? Yeah, there it is. How are you? What is your name? Dinar. Isn't she cute? I was going to talk to y'all this morning. When I used to work, I worked downtown Dallas, and I would go into this, we would go eat out several places, and these girls said, let's go to this place over here. Well, I'd already seen what the place looked like, and it didn't look like anything I wanted to go in and eat at. And we got over there, and when I looked, I would see businessmen wearing suits going into this place. And I'm thinking, how bad can it be if they're going in there? So what was I doing whenever I didn't want to go, and I was going by what this building looked like? What was I doing? What was I doing, Chatham? Judging it by its cover. Absolutely. Have you, and you've heard that before, don't judge a cover. What is it? Don't judge a book by its cover? Yeah. What you see on the outside, you don't see on the inside, right? Yeah. So anyway, I was thinking, you know, a lot of times we do judge everything by the way it looks on the outside. We don't think about the inside, do we? And isn't it great that God does not judge us by our cover? How does he judge us? He doesn't really judge us, but what does he look at inside of us? Our heart. And what does our heart tell him? What do we care about things? Love, joy, kindness. So a lot of times when you see people and you look at them and you're thinking, I don't want to get to know them. But you know what? Sometimes those people can be your best friend. And a lot of times, they're just really shy. So you can't go by the way they look. We have to kind of look, we have to see what their inside is like. Okay? So, if you will, well, their heart. You have to know, you have to, you know, get to know them by their heart. Yeah. You're just making a face, okay? All right. All right, if you will, bow your heads and we'll pray, okay? Dear God, thank you for your love. Help us to not judge others, but to look at their heart. In Jesus' name, amen.
Sadness, wherever you've been, come brokenhearted, let rescue begin. Come find your mercy, the sinner come near. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't heal. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't heal. So lay down your burden. Lay down your shame, and all who are broken, lift up your face. You are. And all of those who've strayed, come sit at the table, come taste the grace. There's rest for the weary, a rest that endures. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't cure. So lay down your burdens, lay down your shame. All who are broken, lift up your face. You're not too far, so lay down your heart, lay down your heart, come as you are, come as you are, fall in his arms, come as you are. There's joy for the morning, O sinner, be still. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't heal. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't heal. So lay down your burdens, lay down your shame. Broken, lift up your face. Oh, wanderer, come home. You're not too far. So lay down your heart, lay down your heart. Come as you are. Come as you are, come as you are, come as you are.
You know, sitting here and thinking at the beginning of our service, some words came to me. A couple weeks ago, I was a part of a conference in Nashville, Tennessee that was just awesome. Loved being there, loved being a part of that service. And there was a speaker we had by the name of Mike Pellavacci. And Tracy's already well, story for another time, but Mike Pellavacci, he was a youth director in London, and one of his youth that he had was a guy by the name of Matt Redman, who is a very prominent worship leader. But Mike Pellavacci, he said, you know, when the Spirit is moving, or when you feel the Holy Spirit telling you to do something, to do it. Because nobody's going to die. Nobody's going to get hurt. But I think it's important to hear, and it's important to listen. So before we go through what I have prepared for my message today, I thought it'd be appropriate for us just to spend a little more time in prayer. There's a lot going on, you know, not just with the prayer concerns that I shared during our prayer times, but if we look at our world, if we look at everything that's happening around us, there is a lot going on. And I think we need to be faithful to what God has called us to do and to spend some time in prayer. So Richard, I'm going to ask you, if you wouldn't mind just to play some like Holy Spirit music or something. It's all on you now, buddy. I'm no. But let's just take a little time to be in prayer. And if you feel, yeah, this is really weird for Methodists, I know. But if you feel like God is calling you to speak something aloud, please feel free to do so. So let's just take some time just to calm our hearts and calm our minds. And let's go to God in prayer. Please pray with me. Oh God, one of the things that you call us to do is to be real. And we come and are real to you at this moment, knowing that we need a Savior, that we need your guidance, that we need you in our lives. And God, while we hear of divided homes, divided a country, divided lives, we pray an outpouring of your Spirit so that we may hear you calling us, so that we may hear how to be the people you have called us to be. So, Lord, we lift up these prayers to you, those spoken and those unspoken. Just allow your Spirit to fill us so that we may be your people. And so, God, we lift these prayers up to you in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. Everybody's still here, right? Yeah, see? Mike was right. Nobody died, so, you know. You know, I just encourage you just to continue to be in prayer. Be in prayer for us as a church. Be in prayer for us as a community. Be in prayer for us as a country. There is a lot going on. And I know it's weighing heavy on a lot of hearts, but thanks be to God that we have a Savior that conquers all of that. That we have a Savior that is there with us. We are continuing our series on community. We're finishing it today. But if you are in your small groups, you may have noticed if you're looking through the books that this is actually an 8-week series. And week 4, 5, and 6 is designated as Be Real. Because, my friends, if we are honest, as Lori sang in the song, you know, we are a mess. And sometimes it's easy for us to put up defenses. It's easy for us to try to put something over who we are. That way the world sees something different than what's really on inside of us. So my hope and my prayer is that as we continue to grow as disciples of Jesus Christ, as we continue to grow as a faithful community, of Jesus Christ, we allow ourselves to be honest. We allow ourselves to be real, to allow God's presence to live in our lives. So, a little boy walks into the back of a church. And on the back of the church, there is a plaque. And the plaque has a bunch of names. And the little boy is staring at this plaque. And the pastor notices the boy looking at this plaque. And he walks up and says, "So, little Bill, what are you looking at?" He says, "Well, I'm looking at this plaque. What are all these names?" And the pastor kind of shakes his head and says, "Yeah, those are the people who died in the service." And the little boy gets this horrified look on his face, and he says, "Which one, the 8:30 or the 11 o'clock? That has absolutely nothing with what I wanted to talk about, but I thought we needed just a little levity. So we're talking about being real. We're talking about what it means to be a part of this community. You know, when we show up, when we pursue God in our lives, when we join in and share. But all of that, I think, can be in vain. Unless there's one thing that we add to all of this. And that is that if we show up and if we are pursuing God and if we are we're joining in, but if we're not real, then I think we tend to miss everything. You know, I know atheists who pursue God. And they pursue God because they want to prove that God is not real. I know people who have this great facade over their lives. They pursue God, but they don't want to allow what's inside to be affected or be touched. I know people pursue God, but they fail to show up to have God speak into their lives. You know, being real can be hard. You know, sometimes we're even rewarded for putting up a front, aren't we? We're rewarded if we show up to wherever we are and we have this facade over our lives. But what God really wants, God wants who we are. Truly are. Our scripture for this morning comes from the book of 1 Samuel. Before we get to our scripture, just a little history or a little backstory about this passage. The people of Israel are gathering and they're kind of floundering and they're calling for a king. And God anoints Samuel to go and find a king of Israel, and he anoints Saul, and Saul becomes king, and he's doing well, but he does some things that are against what God has called him to do. So God tells Samuel that he needs to go out and anoint a new king. So Samuel leaves, and then he takes off and he goes to this little town called Bethlehem. And he runs into Jesse, who has a bunch of sons. And as he walks into Jesse's home, he says, doesn't really say what he's there for, but he's there to anoint the new king. And he invites Jesse to bring all of his sons forward. And one by one, Jesse brings his sons forward. And God tells Samuel that each son is not the son that God is looking for. So we have these words in 1 Samuel 16, verse 7. But the Lord said to Samuel, "Have no regard for his appearance or stature, because I haven't selected him." God doesn't look at things like humans do. Humans see only what is visible to the eyes, but the Lord sees into the heart. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. If we were to translate that, you know, God doesn't look at those things that we like to use to build ourselves up. But God looks inside each and every one of us. And that is what God wants. God wants our hearts. God wants who we are. Wholly and truly, God wants our vulnerability. God wants our desire for Him. God wants all that we have and not all that we want to show others that we have. There are three traits that I look at what it means to be real. And we're going to kind of go over those real quickly. And there are three characters in Scripture that I think really highlights what these traits are. The first is King David himself. David is the one that Jesse went to go anoint to be the king over all of Israel. And whenever I look at David, I see someone who is transparent. If you read through the stories in 1 and 2 Samuel, you see all of the time that David is transparent with who he is. All of his faults, all of his good things, all of the things that David does is to try to pursue after God. That's why in the book of Acts we hear the writer say that David was a man after God's own heart. David was very transparent with everything that he was doing when his followers were pursuing Saul. David had many opportunities to kill Saul. But each time he just kind of left a message and say, look, you are God's anointed and I will not raise a hand against you because of that. But I don't understand why you're chasing after me. I am here for you. And even after he was caught in his moment of sin with Bathsheba, and Nathan came to him and called him out on it, David admitted that he was a sinner and that he was at fault. And this is where we get Psalm 51, where David says, create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. But to fully understand and to fully see the transparency that David had, we have to go later in the Psalms, in Psalm 139, where he writes, examine me, God. Look at my heart. Put me to the test. Know my anxious thoughts. Look to see if there is any adulterous ways in me. And then lead me on the eternal path. That's not a picture of transparency. I don't know what is. To allow God to take a look at his life and say, God, where am I seeking other things besides you? Where am I letting all of the trappings of the world around me be held up before you? See, these are ways that we can be transparent to God, transparent to what He is calling us to do. A second trait of being real is that you have to be passionate. I think in order to be real, you have to be passionate to what God has called you to do. And one of the most passionate men in the Bible has to be Peter. If you look throughout the Gospels, you see one of the most hot-headed, impulsive men ever written about in Scripture. But the reason why is because he had passion for Christ. He had passion for the mission that he was on. When Jesus took Peter, James, and John up to the Mountain of Transfiguration. And in this moment, Jesus is lit up, and Moses and Elijah show up beside him. Peter looks at this great view and says, we have to do something about this. We have to build three tents, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah. And then we need to put up a ticket booth, and we need to have people come up here and just celebrate this moment. And Jesus had to pat him on the shoulder and say, no, that's not what this is about. This isn't about this moment. This is about Christ being lifted up. And I wish we could say that was the only moment that Peter and his passion got ahead of him. Another time is as the disciples were going across the water on the Sea of Galilee. They were riding in this boat, and the waves were starting to get a little rocky, and they see this ghost out in the middle of the Sea of Galilee. And all the disciples start to freak out. They're wondering, what in the world is going on here? And then they realize that it wasn't a ghost, it was Jesus. So here goes Peter again. God, if that's you, Jesus, if that's you, just tell me to come on out there and I'll be right there. And Peter goes out in the water because of his passion for Christ. And then as Jesus is sharing about who he is with passion, Peter cries out among the disciples, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus commands him and says, you know, you will be the one that I will build my church. You are the rock. And then a couple of verses after that, when Jesus talks about how he is going to be given up and how he will die, Peter stands up with that passion again and said, nope, not you. That's not going to happen. Nope, not ever. No way. We'll make sure it doesn't. And shortly before, when Jesus called Peter the rock, he calls Peter Satan and tells Peter to get behind him because he did not fully understand. See, passion sometimes can get in the way. Passion can make us act impulsively, but I believe in order to be real, we have to have passion in our lives. And that passion turns into authenticity. And the disciple that I see that shows authenticity is one that we don't hear much about. We hear negative words about, but it's the disciple Thomas. Thomas only speaks in Scripture two times in the Gospel of John. And in these two times, Thomas is the disciple that kind of looks there and scratches his head and go, you know, I just don't get it. You're going to have to spell it out for me just a little bit more. Sometimes we as humans, we know that we don't understand, or we know that we may need some extra hints, but we'll sit there and we'll go, oh yeah, absolutely, we know exactly what's going on. We know exactly what you meant by that, Jesus. But when Jesus was sharing about the place that he was going, he said that, you know where I'm going. And the disciples, I'm sure, are all shaking their heads going, yes, and Thomas like going, you're going to have to spell it out to us because we don't know. And then later, after Christ has resurrected from the dead, Thomas was missing from the upper room and Jesus appeared to the other disciples. And when Thomas showed back up, he said the famous words that we give the words doubting Thomas to. said, I need to see for myself the nail scars in his hands and in his feet and put my hand in his side and then I'll believe. You know, while we have a tendency to doubt or say that what Thomas was doing was wrong, I think what Thomas was doing was very authentic. And we have that in our own lives where we need to see, where we need to actually touch and feel the presence of God in our lives. See, being real, I think, means, for me at least, that we haven't arrived yet. And it's going to be a while before we arrive. It's going to be a while before we fully understand what Jesus has called us to do. But the best way for us to be real is to be in community, to have people alongside of us to help us, to guide us, to lead us, to be in those questions that we have in our lives. To have other people speak into our lives to allow God's goodness and grace to be real to us. It's hard to be vulnerable sometimes. It's hard to allow others in. But thanks be to God that we have a Savior who has come for us so that we can allow our guard down, so that we can allow God's Spirit to move in and through our lives, so that we can proclaim together. Now, while we may not have it all together, which we don't have it all together, that there is a God who walks with us in our doubt. There is a God who walks with us in our impulsivity. There is a God who loves us and cares for us, who desires for us to be known as his brothers and sisters. So, my brothers and sisters, the call is to be real. In a world that is full of fake, and a world that is called to be all put together, when we understand that we're not, God lifts us up. Let us pray. Oh God, you have given us examples of what it means to be real. And yes, all three of those examples of David and of Peter and of Thomas, they're all flawed. But God, so are we. But thanks be to God that you have sent Jesus to take the mess that we live in, to redeem it. Not so that we can boast about what we are able to do, but so that we can be a living example of your love and your grace. That we may be your hands and feet. That we may be those who are known because of the love that you have given us. So God, we lift these things up in the strong name of the one who loves us, who gives us life and life abundantly, Jesus our Lord. Amen. So, we have an invitation. And I think the invitation is that we need to be real with each other. We need to be real to allow our guard down. to allow God to move inside of our hearts and start of our lives, to not try to be what other people want us to be, but to be who God has truly called us to be, sons and daughters of the living God. You know, after worship today, we have our fifth Sunday brunch, which will be through this door into Wesley Hall. There's a bunch of great food, a lot of great fellowship, but I'm also excited because we will be baptizing seven kiddos right out here, kind of by our prayer garden. We have an infant, we have 3 3-year-olds, we have 3 grade school age children who the parents or they themselves who have not been baptized have said, I want to be baptized today. This will be also an opportunity after we get done baptizing all of our kiddos, if you want to take an opportunity to remember your own baptism. Remember that God has marked you to walk by the trough that we have set up there, and you can touch the water and touch it to your head, or remember that you have been baptized. You have been marked as one of God's children. So we celebrate that today. And we celebrate all that God is doing in the life of our church. So invite you to stand as we sing our song of commitment, Step by Step. For being here, and thank you for worshiping with us this morning. We hope you are blessed, and we hope that you will share with a friend. Just real quick, just invite you to go over to Wesley Hall. I'm going to change into something else because I don't want to do the baptisms in this. So I'm going to go change real quick. So probably, I think I said 10 o'clock, we'll probably gather around the trough to do our baptism. So invite you to come out and celebrate with us. Now receive this benediction. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen. And go in peace.